I will continue Wuthering Heights from where I had left. Now, in the previous class, we had done just the basic informations about the basic concepts and themes about the novel, about the novelist, and a few details about the novel which would help you understand the novel better. We have spoken about the genre of the novel. We have spoken about other related information, like the novel is told, the novel is actually diary inputs by Lockwood as narrated by Nellie Dean. So these kind of things. So we'll move into the characters today. Now these are not, these are just an identification of characters. Now Wuthering Heights is a text which has a huge number of characters, a plethora of different characters who have different influences on the plot, who are very minutely related to each other. And so it is a very confusing novel in terms of characterization. So unlike The Picture of Dorian Gray, where I had just given you a list of the major and the minor characters, I am not going to do that. I have given you a list of the character, the important characters that we need to know about. There are other characters we do not need to know about, and who they are. So we will approach the story of the novel, the plot of the novel, by addressing the characters and how they influence the plot, like we had done in The Picture of Dorian Gray. But this is not that. If you are of the impression that this is how the characters influence the plot and their importance in the novel, no. This is just an identification of the character, who they are. This is very important in terms of Wuthering Heights, because as I told you, there are a number of characters. All of them are very intricately interwoven with each other, very minutely associated with each other. Someone is someone's foster brother, someone is someone's foster sister, but considered to be a servant. And so there are, the characterization is quite complex. And this is something that you need to give to the novelist. This is something that you need to give to the novelist. You have to applaud Bronte here because it's not just a very linear characterization with a linear plot. It is a complex, multifarious characterization with many plot structures converging together, diverging from each other, but keeping a relationship with each other. So there is not just one story. There are multiple stories happening in this novel, and all of them are bound by a thread. So this speaks volumes of the ability that the novelist possesses, especially someone who was not given traditional education, mostly self-taught, home-tutored. So you can just have an idea or realize the level of acumen that the Bronte sisters possessed. So the first and the most important character around whom the entire novel rotates is Heathcliff. He has no first name, he has no last name. He has one name, which is Heathcliff. He's an orphan who is picked from London by Mr. Earnshaw, the actual owner of Wuthering Heights, which is the name of the mansion. And he comes to live with Mr. Earnshaw and his family. Now, Mr. Earnshaw is married to Mrs. Earnshaw and has two children, one daughter and one son, Catherine, the daughter, and Hindley, the son. Now, with Heathcliff coming into the picture, Catherine and Heathcliff become, even though Heathcliff is brought from London, but Heathcliff is described not in a very gentlemanly manner. His dress is very unkempt. He does not know how a gentleman behaves. And so from the very beginning, Hindley takes disliking towards Heathcliff. But Heathcliff forms a strong friendship with Catherine, the daughter, with whom it changes with time into romance. and the entire plot unfolds there. So he is the main character. It is the Wuthering Heights is perhaps, if Wuthering Heights is to be described in a sentence, it is Heathcliff's story of love and revenge for not getting his love. And you will find words like Byronic hero and so on and so forth here. I will describe Byronic hero in details when what about Byronic hero is. When we do Heathcliff from the point of the plot, not the identification. So what you need to know is that Heathcliff is an orphan. He was picked up from London by Mr. Earnshaw, comes to live at Wuthering Heights. He's hated by Mr. Earnshaw's son, Hindley, but is loved by Mr. Earnshaw's daughter, Catherine. Next is Catherine Earnshaw. Now, Catherine, her name is Catherine Earnshaw, but at the latter half of the novel, she becomes Catherine Linton because she marries someone called Edgar Linton. Now, Catherine, who is Catherine? Catherine is Mr. Earnshaw's daughter who takes a liking to Heathcliff, but does not get married to Heathcliff. Once she gets introduced to the life of the lords, the life of landlords, the gentle, disciplined, gentleman and gentle womanly lives of the Lintons who live in Thrushcross Grange, which was just across the moors from Wuthering Heights. So basically, Wuthering Heights is a story about two houses. The Earnshaws living in Wuthering Heights and the Lintons living in Thrushcross Grange. And there comes Heathcliff from London, and hence starts the story. The story ends with Heathcliff owning both Wuthering Heights and Thrushcross Grange. And the line of the Earnshaws and the line of the Lintons almost like merging into a line of the Heathcliffs. So one day during the summer when Catherine was just running about in the moors playing, she comes across Thrushcross Grange and she's fascinated by the lordly stature of Thrushcross Grange and the Lintons living there. And she gets greatly, and she starts admiring the gentleman and the gentlewomanly way, the upper class way of life. And it is this that makes her reject Heathcliff in marriage and marry the son of the Lintons, Edgar. But of course, that marriage is not a very fruitful one, because even though Catherine marries Edgar out of societal pressure, she never loved Edgar, and the honesty of her love was always for Heathcliff. Now, it is needless to say, the previous class I was speaking about how this is a story of Heathcliff's revenge. More than romance is depicted in the story, it is revenge which is depicted, because Heathcliff, after he's rejected by Catherine, ventures away off to London again, makes money, comes back, and then starts to indulge in revenge for the life that he did not have, the life that he dreamt of having with Catherine, but he could not have because he was not wealthy and powerful. So he starts taking revenge on the Lintons in various ways. He starts endeavoring to desire both the Heights and the Grange, trying to make everything his, to see that he becomes the owner of everything. And in doing that, he destroys whatever is left of his relationship with Catherine. And Catherine dies a very sad death, pining and disappointed on Heathcliff. And at last, Heathcliff dies in a mad frenzy, again, pining for Catherine. Now, Edgar Linton is the son of the Lintons who live in Thrushcross Grange. Edgar's styles and manners are in sharp contrast to that of Heathcliff. who constantly dislikes him, and of Catherine, who is drawn to him. Now, Catherine, this is something that you need to know. Catherine, what we mean about temperance and passion. Catherine's liking towards Linton, Edgar Linton, was one of temperance. It was a very surface thing. It was a very on the surface thing. But Catherine's liking towards Heathcliff was very passionate. It was much more psychological and it was much more sexual. Catherine marries Edgar Linton instead of Heathcliff because of his highest social status, and this leads to disastrous results. Then is Nellie Dean. Now, Nellie Dean is a foster sister of the Earnshaws who is treated as a servant. So, Nellie Dean is Hindley and Catherine's foster sister, but she's treated as a servant in Wuthering Heights. And Lockwood knows about the story of Wuthering Heights from Nellie Dean. Now, this is very important. All the characters about Heathcliff, Catherine, everything that we get to hear of the Lintons and the Heathcliffs and the Earnshaws and the Heights and the Grange is from Nellie Dean's perspective. So there is always a question about faithfulness. If the description of Heathcliff, if the description of Catherine is actually how Heathcliff and Catherine were, or if the description of Edgar is actually how Edgar was. It is Nellie's perception of the characters and the situations, not perhaps the actual characters and the actual situation. Now, next we come to Isabella Linton. Isabella Linton is Edgar Linton's sister. Isabella is not directly is influencing the plot for quite a long time in the novel, but she bursts out onto the scene once Heathcliff returns from London, a wealthy man. And now I pointed out that I would speak about a Byronic hero in the next lecture, but I must tell you at least something about who a Byronic hero is to justify Isabella's attraction towards Heathcliff. Now, Byronic hero, which has its roots from the poems of Lord Byron, from the poems of Lord Byron, where now this is a romantic hero, which is the romantic heroes were all larger than life characters. They had no ill qualities. They were virtuous. They were moralistic. They were dashing. They were superb characters. Now the Byronic hero is not such a romantic character, is not such a heroic character. He's almost like an anti-heroic character. We may even say that the Byronic hero is close to us than the other romantic heroes, close to us as human beings. So the Byronic hero has a dark side within him. A Byronic hero does not only have virtues, a Byronic hero also has banes. A Byronic hero may be greedy, may feel the urge to betray, may be very selfish and individualistic, may be very lustful. So Byronic hero is almost like every human person, not completely filled with virtues, has some banes. A Byronic hero is someone who has weaknesses. The romantic heroes had no weaknesses. They had a remedy for all weaknesses. But the Byronic hero had weaknesses and they succumbed to those weaknesses, and which was an exhibition of their psychologies. They were very complex characters, very psychologically complex characters, who just like they could champion something, would also break down into 1,000 bits. So this was a Byronic hero, and a Byronic hero was very passionate. A Byronic hero was very psychological. So it's almost like a Byronic hero is almost like a sweet poison. You know the thing perhaps is not good for you in the long run, but its rudimentary attraction towards your psychology is something that you cannot stop. Heathcliff is such a character. Heathcliff he's a hero, but he's more an anti-hero than he's a hero. So he breaks down, he stands up, he champions causes, he becomes wealthy, he's driven by revenge, which is a bane, he loves passionately. So Heathcliff is a Byronic hero. And this psychological aspect of the character is what attracts Isabella Linton towards Heathcliff. To Isabella, who has been born and brought up at the Grange among the gentle Lintons, suddenly she comes across a man who has no qualms in expressing his emotions, may it be anger, may it be love, may it be hatred. So this is something very true to Isabella. She is attracted to Heathcliff. Heathcliff uses this attraction in his bid to acquire revenge on both Catherine and Edgar. So he uses Isabella, he marries Isabella, even though he has no ounce of love for Isabella. And Isabella's post-marital life is one of great desperation and distress. Heathcliff is quite abusive towards Isabella, and Isabella runs off to London, where Isabella gives birth to their child. The child's name is Linton. So again, this is a very, very ironic. Isabella is born a Linton. She marries and becomes a Heathcliff. And she names her child while dying on her deathbed Linton, which is her family name. Hindley Earnshaw, there's nothing much to know about Hindley Earnshaw. You can read what I've written on the slide here. But Hindley Earnshaw is, he does not like Heathcliff. He's not a very masochistic character. He ruins everything that Mr. Earnshaw had built and created over a period of time. When Heathcliff returns back to the moors, the way he acquires, he gets to know that Hindley is in debts, and he gambles with Hindley and to see that he's more entranced in debts, and buys Wuthering Heights and Thrushcross Grange from buys Wuthering Heights from Hindley. So this is all that you need to know, that just like Hindley had been very abusive towards Heathcliff in childhood, Heathcliff becomes very abusive towards Hindley once he comes back from London in their adulthood. Hareton is the son of Hindley and Francis Earnshaw. Francis becomes an Earnshaw after marriage. Francis gives birth to Hareton Earnshaw and dies, and it is almost the death of Francis that triggers Hindley to go into an alcoholic depression, which Heathcliff uses to occupy Wuthering Heights. Cathy Linton is the daughter of Edgar and Catherine Linton. Cathy Linton is married off to Linton Heathcliff, who is Heathcliff and Isabella's son. Now, as you can understand, the names are becoming very confusing. The plot is becoming very confusing. So this is a very confusing novel. So you need to read the summary. You need to read the characters. Go to Wikipedia. The Wikipedia entry of Wuthering Heights is fantastic. If you can read the Wikipedia page from the beginning to the end, I can assure you, you will have a very good idea about the story, the plot, the characters, and everything. So Cathy Linton is Heathcliff's daughter-in-law. She marries Linton Heathcliff. She does not marry. She is again forced to marry Linton Heathcliff by his father Heathcliff. And Cathy is the daughter of Edgar and Catherine, the Catherine that Heathcliff loved. Linton Heathcliff is the son of Heathcliff and Isabella. He's a very weak child, and he learns of his father's identity only after his mother dies, because while she was pregnant, Isabella ran off to London to save Linton from Catherine, from Heathcliff's scourge. Linton was rescued by Edgar, but after Edgar's death, Heathcliff takes up his son and helps him grow. Linton dies of tuberculosis at a very tender age. This is a family tree that you have seen here, that I have put here. If you can look a little minutely, I know the writings may be a little illegible, but if you can look at it minutely, the entire family tree is chalked out here. And please go through the family tree. So these are the characters that you need to know. I will be ending this lecture here. I'm not going to go deeper. I'll give you some time to get accustomed to the characters, who they are, what they do, who they marry, when they die, who their fathers and mothers are. So this will help you. So as you can see, the pink line is a child. The pink dotted line is a foster child. And the black dotted line is a foster child who is treated as a servant. And the black line is the marriage line. As you can see, Mr. Earnshaw, black line, Mrs. Earnshaw, so they are married. Pink line, Hindley, Catherine, which it means they are sons. Hindley and Nellie Dean, black dotted line, it means foster sister, butter servant. So yeah, please study this, this will help you. And then I've come up with a timeline, please. This will again help you understand the plot, who is born when, who dies when, who marries who. So before we go into the novel proper, the politics of the novel, I want you to have a very clear idea about who the characters are, what happens when, who marries whom, who's trying to take revenge upon whom, who loves whom. These information, because this otherwise Wuthering Heights will be all jumbled up inside your head and you will just get messed up. Now, if you want this timeline, you can go to the Wikipedia page. You will find this exact timeline on the Wikipedia page. And I would suggest that you please follow this timeline from the Wikipedia page. And please try to, if you can, memorize the timeline, what happens when. Again, so I'll be stopping this lecture here. I hope you have understood this much. It's very confusing, I know. So I advise you to self-study a bit. And if you have any problems, you can contact me.